Why, hello everyone. Welcome to the program Illumination. We come from the library of Sunset Lodge 369 in Santa Monica, California. It's great to have you with us today. My name is Les Jones, the producer, and man in the hot seat is our great friend and brother Michael Womack. We're here to discuss all things Masonic, whether it's our people, our teachers, our leaders, whatever, and also things around Masonry. And we're here to help you and find out a lot more about who and what we are. If you've got any questions, please feel free to contact us. There are two ways to do it, via our email address, which is sunsetmasoniclodge369@gmail.com. That's sunsetmasoniclodge369@gmail.com. And our web address, which is sunsetmasoniclodge.org. That's sunsetmasoniclodge.org. We would love to hear from you. We're here most Tuesday nights. If you want to come by, be sure and send us an email. Just double check to make sure we're open. We're open at 6:30 in the evening, where we have our meal. We have a bite to eat together. And at 7:30, whatever event we have going on. If you're a brother, we'd love to see you. If you're coming by and you're not a Mason, stop by. We'd love to see you and have a bite to eat with you. Everything is great with our lodge. And as I've mentioned many times before, we've had an influx of good young people and their wonderful energy here. And one of the new brothers who is with us and is our guest today is Brother Sergio. Brother Sergio, how you doing, man?
Hi, Les. First of all, thank you for having me, for you, Michael. Thank you for the invitation.
Least we could do. Now, Brother Sergio is from Chile. Is that correct?
I am, right.
Right. And I mentioned in the lodge one time that I feel a really strong kinship for Brother Sergio being from Chile. If you take the Texas flag and the Chilean flag and put them next to each other, they look almost exactly alike. So my brother, we're tight, okay?
Yeah. I remember once an embassy in Chile, when there's National Day, it's a law that you need to put the flag out there, the Chilean flag. Somebody put the Texas one.
Ooh.
And they got a ticket.
It was in the news.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah, that happened.
Well, thank you. It's great to have you here, talk a little bit. Now, to start things off, just tell us about yourself and where you grew up, of course, Chile, and your life growing up and so forth.
Okay, so my name is Sergio Torres-Letelier. I was born in mid-south Chile in a town that is called Concepción. But then my parents split, so I went to live in the mid-north in another city that is called La Serena. I grew up there. It's like a Santa Barbara kind of city, while Concepción is more like Alaska kind of thing.
Really?
My dad is still there. I go visit. I've been visiting the whole time. I have friends there. And it's a fun town because I never studied or got education there, so it was always vacation time over there. But I grew up in La Serena, and until I went to college, then I moved to Santiago. Capital, yeah.
Chile itself is pretty long, isn't it?
Yeah. That's what I said, mid-north, mid-south, because if you look in the map, La Serena and Concepcion are still very close in the map, though it's like 10 hours driving from each, and Santiago is in the middle.
The weather you were talking about.
Oh, yeah, it changes a lot, like the south.
If you
south
go far
rainy.
South, you've got the really cold weather.
Yes.
And you go to the very north, you've got very tropic.
Yeah, not tropic, but incredibly dry, like California.
Right.
And up north is just desert and like Mojave Desert or something.
Okay,
like
so that's what it was like for you growing up in the area?
Yeah.
Awesome, good. Now, how did you even get the idea of becoming a Mason?
It's interesting because my dad, some cousins, my granddad, they're Masons.
Right.
And Masonry, and I have an aunt who is a Mason too, and female lodges and all stuff. But I grew up with the idea of like, what is a Mason, what the organization is. And it was a random friend who said like, Sergio, you should definitely join Masonry here in Santiago when I was already in college. And I really liked the idea because I knew what they were. I feel attached through my family. Yeah. But at the same time, I forgot to mention that I'm an artist. I'm a musician. So when I was like 20, 22, I was trying to find more gravitas in my life.
Right.
We're not religious people. So gravitas for us, or like more depth, or like more intellectual stuff. Sure. We're like reading. My mom's a very philosophy person and all that stuff. But my dad too. Masonry for me offers something that in Chile is a little bit more liberal than here. So, I mean, about the divinity, about religion and all that. And it was like a place of free thinkers. It is here too. And I really like the idea of the philosophy and the study of the esoteric and all that. I was digging for
it. And that was part of it there in Chile, huh? Right, you were talking about how religious is, because Chile, I would imagine, is very Christian religious type of place. I hate to say community since there's such a long amount, so many different types of people. Did it have much more of a Christian slant than anything?
It is actually, you're talking about Masonry or like
the society? Masonry.
Oh, no, at all. Actually, Masonry is one of the, it comes from France, the Orient of France. So it's very agnostic. It's very, if theist. You know, like there's a little, like people believe in something, but not a religious God within the Freemasonry. It's not a thing to be religious. Of course, we have people from Christians, Catholic who are Masons.
Of course.
But the country's incredibly not Christian, but very Catholic.
Right.
And Choinstad and Opus Dei are like huge. Right. So Masonry itself in Chile is very secretive. You don't tell that you're a Mason. There, like, even if we see each other on a coffee, we will be very, very like, we'll understand that we are in a public environment because it's so common that people get fired because somebody knows that you're a Mason.
Really?
Yeah, it's a very strong thing. It's kind of changing, and Masons are very liberal there, so they're trying to help like abortion and all those social issues, but they are still seeing like liberal people, free thinkers, and religion is kind of against us. Like Chile is a very conservative Catholic
right, of country. Course. But so, people actually lose their job because of that, huh?
Yeah, so I like three brothers of like the lodge that I was initiated, they tell the story that their boss, who was Opus Dei or belonged to like a Christian thing, as soon as they know that you're a Mason, they will kind of start making things complicated for you. And it's mostly ignorance. I mean, they don't know, they don't understand Freemasonry, and they're afraid, and probably their churches say like, they're bad people, and you get fired. It's a thing,
That's everywhere.
Yeah. Of course, me, my family, my parents, we are Masons. We're open about it because we really like to change that stigma around Freemasons.
So for the most part, you wouldn't be wearing a ring.
Yeah,
like
it's forbidden in Chile. You are not supposed to.
Really?
I mean, you can do whatever you want, but they say you shouldn't. Be using anything, and it's not a common thing to see that, like on the car, or no at all. We don't march. We don't. We're not that out there. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's why also they focus more in like in lodge work.
Right.
A lot of philosophy, a lot of history of Freemasonry. So that's the way. I like that.
Yeah. And honestly, whatever spiritual faith you're a member of, that's also a wonderful thing to be a part of.
Right.
You were talking about how your family, many of your family members were Masons. Did you ever go to a lodge where you were growing up?
Yeah, to a funeral. When my grandpa died, we went to his lodge, and he was being, the whole thing was happening there. And then we have the funeral with the Mason kind of ceremony.
Yes.
And that was the first time that we saw like Masons in action, and it was pretty cool. It was 2000, so I was probably like 16.
Right.
And I saw them like getting together. It's a very nice ceremony that happens. And it was kind of weird because it was in a cemetery. So everybody around my friends were like, dude, these are Masons in a cemetery doing their stuff. So it was pretty interesting. But of course we understood the meaning of what we're doing, and it was pretty beautiful. And that's when that was actually the only one. And lodges anniversaries, like they threw parties, they call it the white parties, because you have to dress kind of like in white, like So, and that's like an open thing, and you will invite family inside of the temple, and they will explain what we do, and there's also like a tribute to a woman, like they give flowers, and it's a pretty nice thing, and then it's a dinner and a dance.
All right, and
so those kind of things.
Sure, you brought up something. Your aunt was a Mason too.
Yeah.
Was she? She was part of another fraternity there.
Yes. I don't know much about here, but in Chile you have the male Grand Lodge, and then there is a female Grand Lodge. They kind of support each other, but totally separate. And she belonged to the female one.
Right. We had one of the worshipful masters from the female lodge on our program before.
Right.
What a wonderful group.
To receive that, right?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And I wish we were, that's a goal of mine.
Yeah.
Just to see us come together and work together on things where we could keep our own separate things. And and that's a wonderful thing that we do that. But we have so much in common not to come together and support each other and work together on many different things.
In Chile, both Grand Lodges, they support each other a lot. But I'm not sure if you can visit.
Oh, that's fine. I understand.
But they support like publicly a lot. Yeah.
Right. And I think it's important for us to keep our separation because of the very special things each of us bring to our members. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very, very important.
And you know what is interesting too? Like male lodges, like the Grand Lodge of Chile, all of the wives or partners of like Masons, they have their own kind of clubs that they do stuff. Like they donate money, they go to the Red Cross and stuff like that. They're very active.
Like something separate, like...
Yeah, it's like a, I don't know, like a club. It's,
yeah.
Yeah. So, and each lodge has its own club, And then as soon as you become a Mason, they ask if you have a partner or like even your daughters or like whatever, siblings. Oh, wow. And they're allowed to join that community and they meet and they do dinners, bingos and stuff like that. Yeah.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting, yeah.
All right, here we go. Mm-hmm. So we're getting up to things. You find out, you know, your family members, you've been to the lodge just a little bit. What got you to take the step to become a Mason?
As I mentioned before, I was really looking for a place where I can grow up as a human, an artist, to understand more the society around me and myself. So when I was actually able to join, I say yes right away because of that. Like, I really wanted to go into what like this organization could do for my own growth. Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's been like that forever. Like, I mean, I know some other people joined because of the fraternity. And, I think it's a very individual kind of path. And I've learned a lot from Freemasonry. About myself through Freemasonry.
It's really good because your path is separate from mine, separate from Brother Michael's. And that's what makes it unique. We come together and we share with each other on our different paths.
Yeah.
All right, I just want to remind everybody, this is the program Illumination, and we come from the library at Sunset Lodge 369 in Santa Monica, California. Want to get in touch with us? Send us an email at sunsetmasoniclodge369@gmail.com. That's sunsetmasoniclodge369@gmail.com. Go to our website also, which is sunsetmasoniclodge.org. That's sunsetmasoniclodge.org. We're here most Tuesday nights. We have a meal at 6:30. We would love to see you. If you're a brother and you're coming through the Los Angeles area, we would love to see you come by. We're here most Tuesday nights. Send us an email just in case to let us know. And if you're not a Mason and you're in the area or you're going to be in the area soon, you're more than welcome. Just sit down and have a bite to eat with us, and we love to see you. Our guest, by the way, my name is Les Jones, the producer. A man in the hot seat is Brother Michael Walbach. Thank you for all you do, Brother Michael. And Sergio is our guest. And Sergio's one of the newer people in our lodge, and you bring a lot of great energy here, my friend.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for that. Now, we've got you interested in being a Mason. Which lodge did you first start in?
I started in a lodge called Aurora d'Italia. I'm not sure how to translate that, like Italian Aurora, in a way. It was founded by Italians in Chile 100 years ago, I guess. And I joined that one. And it's in Santiago, and it works under the Grand Lodge building.
All right, awesome. And did you do your first degree there?
Yeah. Initiation and then the second one.
All right. And then you came here for your third degree.
Right. I got my second degree on a Friday. I was here to study in Boston on a Sunday. So I got the second degree and I didn't experience the second degree like in a meeting or like and I just flew to Boston to study. Wow. So it was an interesting thing that starting from my second degree up, it's been an American Masonry rather than Chilean. Yeah.
Now, what brought you to Sunset Lodge?
Okay, so after I graduated from Boston, I moved to LA and I lived in Venice. The first, right. Like I arrived there. So I just searched a lodge nearby and I saw ours, Sunset, and I saw Culver City as well. But when I read about this lodge, it's very artistic. There's a lot of like easygoing like brothers, and it's like a not laid back lodge, but I love that. I think on the website they have the description and say like, even though we are kind of like laid back, we are a serious lodge.
Yes.
And I loved it. So I visited and then I started coming to the meetings and then finally I joined.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right. That's great. So you've joined and we talked a little bit about the degrees.
Right.
And you know yourself, you've watched our program. Right. So I like to go through the degrees of what people have done. Tell me about your first degree. What was it like? First of all, what was the mindset when you were coming up to doing the degree before you even did anything?
The first one?
Yes.
Because
you know nothing about what's going on.
Yeah,
know?
Absolutely. It changes a little bit. Like I took the first degree in Chile.
Right.
So the whole ceremony is different that I've seen here. In a way similar but different, I just let myself like enjoy it. I thought the whole time that I was joining this organization, which my family already belongs, that it would be up to high standards, and my parents were like, my dad was very proud. So I just like experienced it. I don't remember, well, now I remember what a first degree is, but at that time I didn't get almost nothing for the whole experience. It was too much information a lot.
Yeah, that's really it. I think I've seen that with all the degrees. There's just so much there that you can't soak it all in one sitting.
And the language and all the information just being provided. So, yeah.
Well, I know Brother Michael and I are the same when it comes to this. When I did my first degree, it's interesting. I never had seen the inside of a lodge before I got my first degree.
Wow.
So then, you know, like I was awakened, so to speak, and I looked around. That's my very first time to ever see the inside of a lodge.
Okay.
And I went, wow, you know?
Right.
And it's an experience. It's a good experience. Nothing bad about it at all. But
yeah, I remember during my first degree in the ceremony in Chile, there is a lot of noises happening. So you kind of get scared a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Everything, of course, has like an explanation and a meaning.
Right.
But you are listening to noises and fire. And yeah, so it's intense.
That'd be awesome to go be a part of, to watch that.
Yeah. When you see it, it's pretty cool how they make the sounds. And all
if we go there, you'll vouch for it.
Definitely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. You've done your first degree. What did you really get out of that first degree?
A lot of history. I mean, in Chile, you have to stay as an apprentice for 2 years, and you have to have 90% of assistant attendance in order to and be with your dues and everything. And all the master masons have to vote you if you're ready to go to the second degree.
Oh, wow.
So the first degree in Chile is a lot of history. A lot of history and the laws about masonry, France and the Scottish Rite, because they mostly work with that rite over there. And a lot of history. And sometimes understand rhetoric. Like they will teach you how to speak. Like there will be exercises about how you pronounce, like, or you get your idea across on a table. There's a lot of formation of you as a person, you know.
Wow.
It's very interesting. Yeah, it's very interesting. And so I got that history and how to present ideas and stuff like that.
So tell me, you said that you needed to be attend 90% of the meeting.
Yeah.
Now, at the meetings, what were the meetings? You were talking about history and so forth.
Yeah.
Is that what all these meetings were about?
Well, in Chile, you meet twice a week. One with the whole lodge and then one with your degrees, only, like the first degree. And when you're meeting with your degree, you will talk about how to speak and some history regarding the first degree. But then when you meet in with the lodge, they will present like general themes, maybe something that is happening in Chile, because you go and there is always somebody doing a presentation about economics, about liberal stuff, about science. So you hear that speech and then they discuss, and you have in every lodge people who is into science or people who is like economics or history. So that the conversation that happens is very interesting. So you listen to very prepare people in any topics. And sometimes ministers, sometimes politicians, sometimes doctors. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. And then there is a dinner. So, yeah, you experience all that, and it's pretty cool.
Now, tell me, you're an entered apprentice for 2 years?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. You get to do the ritual when you meet with your degree, with your level. You meet and you experience the ritual. Somebody has to be the worshipful. Somebody has to be the secretary. And you explore those positions. It's part of it, too.
What an awesome thing to do.
But it's very time consuming. Imagine twice a week.
Yes, but then look at the Mason you are and what it's made. Okay, so let's say the master's voted and you got the okay to do the second degree. Yeah. Tell me about my favorite degree, the second degree.
I've seen it here. It's very similar. That degree is very similar. I like it. You are way more into what Masonry is, so you understand more. So I think it's the one that you enjoy the most in my perspective because you know what the ritual is. You don't know what will happen, but you understand what is happening, what's the meaning of stuff, and so you're way more aware of any word and what the ritual itself is trying to teach you through the experience is pretty interesting.
It's great.
Unfortunately, I never experienced being a second degree in Chile. So as I told you, I got the second degree and flew to Boston. But I went to some second degree, not initiations, but ceremonies in Boston. They were interesting too. And it was a whole different thing. And I've seen it here too.
Yeah, I know in Texas, I went to a third degree there. And it was great because it was way out in the woods. It was outside.
Oh, that's awesome.
And it was, right in the middle of this little clearing.
Uh-huh.
And
nice.
It was great.
So it was outdoors?
It was outdoors, totally. And right there at sunset, and it started getting dark, and it was doing the third degree during that. And it was amazing.
Yeah.
And it was a little different. You know, you could tell it was the third degree. But the nuances of differences are really illuminating. You get a whole different viewpoint of what that is.
Yeah. Just to jump in for a second, guys, and for Sergio's benefit, I know you said you were in Boston for a while. And degrees are definitely done in different places, for sure. And there was a young fellow in Boston that was getting his third degree that was off to join the Navy, and they got a dispensation. They did his third degree on the gun decks of the USS Constitution in Boston Harbor. I thought that would be a pretty cool place to get a degree as well. So it's not just inside the lodge. We've had outdoor degrees here in California
Cool.
So pretty cool.
That's awesome.
That's so interesting. Yeah.
Thank you, Brother Michael. Yeah. That's great. And let me tell you, if you were to stay in Chile, you brought up a little bit about that. You got your second degree. How long do you have to wait before you become a...
Same. It's 2 years minimum. I've known cases, like my cousin,
who's
10 years before becoming a master. It takes a lot. It takes a lot, yeah.
Dedication.
And then, and then it's 20 to 30 years to go to 32. It's a lot of bureaucracy and tests and stuff like that. So it's a different approach of what you become a Master Mason is,
It's difficult, but look at the man you become during all of that.
Well, but it's the first 2 years, my first degree was there. I think I became an American Mason, Master Mason, because from the second degree on, it's been American Freemasonry rather than Chilean. In Chile, so if you count, you won't become a Master Mason in minimum 4 years. That's a lot of things. It's different here. They say, they're in the States and other countries. They're giving away the third degree and stuff. And I say, no, it's just different. It's just a different experience, a different kind of Masonry. So it's not better or worse. It's just different.
Well, I tell you, we could learn a few lessons from what they do.
Right.
That's definitely true. Okay, so here you are at Sunset Masonic Lodge 369.
Yeah.
And you get your third degree here. Mm. Tell me about what it's like.
Well, it was amazing because a little bit like a backstory. Yeah. I actually had the third degree in Boston.
Oh.
But when I came here and Brother Brandon Lopez was the secretary, he helped me a lot to kind of ask for the documentation that what happened in Boston. But he never came. They never sent anything. The Grand Lodge of California contacted them and nothing happened. So the Grand Lodge of California said, you know what, let's go back. Sergio asked for a certificate that you're a second degree in Chile, and you can have your third degree here and let's forget about the other thing. So what was cool that I got my third degree in Boston. Mm. I went to Chile to some third degree meetings,
right?
But then here I wasn't able to attend. But the cool thing is that, again, the whole ritual that I got here was different than the one in Boston.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, it was kind of different in so many ways. Because there was a brother who was also being raised, and he was Scottish, and they did a whole Scottish thing. So with bagpipes, and it was like a different thing. So I was totally not understanding what was happening.
Yeah.
So what I got here is, and it was an amazing experience. Yeah.
Right. I want to bring brother Michael in here right. on this, and I don't yeah. want to bring him in right away. I don't want to shock him, but it's interesting how different ways of doing the third mm-hmm. degree is. Brother Michael, have you heard of these?
There's a lot of different variations. Now, again, a lot of common ground, too, where things are similar. But and generally speaking, every jurisdiction is its own kingdom. So California, there's no one higher than the Grand Master of California. And over the years, various states, as they've kind of, you know, worked with their ritual, they've created their own variations. So it is. Now, again, there's uniformity in the ritual across the state of California. Our grand lecturer sets a standard, and we're expected to follow it. But as you go from state to state and country to country, you're going to find lots of little differences in the ritual. So for sure.
The interesting thing, sorry, Les, the interesting thing was I didn't experience the degree, the whole ceremony. It was one of us who got the whole thing and we were just watching it.
Right.
So, and here I experienced the whole thing.
Right.
And it was totally different.
And that was in Boston, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, it's a whole different thing when you're part of it.
When I said that I didn't experience it, was like
the third degree. Right. Have you seen a third degree here after you received it? Have you been in the audience, so to speak, watching it? Have you had a chance to do that?
I don't think so.
Oh, you'll love it.
Have I? No, I don't think so.
No, you will know. You will know.
Yeah.
Let me tell you.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah.
Okay. Tell me. Okay. Here you are, a brand new Master Mason.
Right.
And you bring a very positive characteristic to our lodge with your energy. What do you see yourself in the future here at Sunset Lodge?
Okay, something that got me from the beginning of Freemasonry is to explore it, to see beyond the lodge. So I really want to be part of whatever the Grand Lodge of California has to offer in programs and conventions and all that. So I really want to get involved outside of the lodge as well as inside, maybe helping with a position and or something like that, whatever I can do.
Okay, there's a lot of wonderful things going outside of this lodge. This is a great point to start off and have a foundation to grow with and throughout the state with the Grand Lodge of California, throughout the country and throughout the world.
And it's the thing that I love being put in positions where I will have to kind of bring my social skills and everything, because here at the lodge, you are among brothers and friends. So when you go out to visit a lodge or like a conference or something related to Masonry, you are really out there exploring what Masonry is outside of your lodge. So that's a thing that is incredibly valuable.
Well, that's wonderful. Sergio, it's been a great honor to have you a part of the program today. You added so much, and you add so much to our lodge. And I really want to thank you for what you do. This has been the program Illumination from Sunset Lodge number 369 in Santa Monica. You can reach us via email at sunsetmasoniclodge369@gmail.com. My name is Celeste Jones, Michael Walback behind the board. We will see you next time.